you've seen the attack ads.
Warning, Drew Edmondson's a liberal, unethical, Hillary-loving career politician.
From both sides.
He protects the same corporate interests as Mary Fallon, not you.
And the promises from the candidates.
From now on, we're going to properly fund education.
But how are they going to do it?
We are going to end politics as usual.
The candidates are here tonight with their answers, from health care to education.
We think it's going to be a close race.
I think Oklahoma voters are going to focus on Oklahoma issues.
KOCO partnering with KJRH in Tulsa and KSWO in Lawton, bringing you the only statewide gubernatorial debate. This is Commitment 2018.
Good evening, I'm KOCO's Jessica Schambach. Thank you for joining us for this special political event being broadcast across Oklahoma tonight, here in the Oklahoma City area and on our partner stations in Lawton and in Tulsa. We have our panel of political experts this evening who will be posing questions to the candidates tonight. We have Monty Brown from KSWO, KOCO's Abigail Ogle and Brett Bagansky, and also Scott Thompson from KJRH. Also want to introduce our gubernatorial candidates this evening, Democrat Drew Edmondson and Republican Kevin Stitt. Gentlemen, welcome. Thank you for being here tonight.
It's good to be here.
Now, prior to tonight's debate, a coin flip determined the order of opening and closing statements. Kevin Stitt won that and elected to take the second opening statement. Drew Edmondson will make the second closing statement. A second coin flip determined which candidate will receive the first question in the first half of this debate. And Kevin Stitt also got that. We also have the rules. Candidate one will be asked a question and have 1 minute to respond. Then candidate two will also have 1 minute to respond, and candidate one will get a 30-second rebuttal. After that, the order will then flip. So let's begin, shall we? First off, Drew Edmondson, you have 2 minutes for your opening statement.
Thank you, Jessica, and it's good to be here. And I want to thank Channel 5 in Oklahoma City, Channel 8 in Tulsa, and Channel 7 in Lawton for simulcasting this debate here tonight. It's going to be an opportunity for us to kind of get aside from the clutter that's on TV with all of the negative ads and actually get into the substance of why this governor's race is important. We're going to talk about education. We're going to talk about why we rank down at the bottom in terms of per capita expenditures on our students. We're going to talk about health care and why national statistics now say that Oklahoma's life expectancy has been downgraded because of our health outcomes in this state. We're going to talk about overcrowded prisons, and we're going to talk about mental health and how we can approach the real problem of reducing prison population by taking care of the drug, alcohol, and mental health needs of our citizens. And I hope we also get to talk about the medical problems and Medicaid expansion and how we can provide a basic level of medical care for our population. All of these are important issues, and all of them are kind of crowded out by the noise in the negative ads. So we may get to talk about those a little bit too. So I'm looking forward to the conversation. Again, I thank the stations for making this time available to us, and I'm looking forward to the questions coming up.
Mr. Edmondson, thank you. Mr. Stitt, you have 2 minutes.
Thank you so much for joining us tonight. You know, I want to start and thank my wife, Sarah. She's a great mother and partner. You know, we built Gateway together. It's a homegrown success story. We now employ 1,200 people. We have offices in 41 states. I couldn't do it without my wife, Sarah. You know, I also want to take a chance to thank my children as well. We've got 6 kids from 18 down to 4. And here's my chance to embarrass them. I love you guys. Now get ready for bed. You know, the truth is my kids are a big part, reason that I'm running for governor. I didn't know anything about politics, didn't know any politicians, but I got so tired of seeing my state, the state that I love, struggle, being at the top of all the lists we shouldn't be, like incarceration rates, and being at the bottom of all the lists we shouldn't be, like job growth and education. And I just don't think that the, you know, I've watched my state struggle also from crisis to crisis, a $1 billion budget deficit, 4-day school weeks, scandal after scandal. But just it seemed like the career politicians, their only answer was new taxes on you and your family. I think we can change that. With the right leadership, Oklahoma can be a top 10 state. You know, as your next governor, I'm going to put us on a path to be top 10. Top 10 in job growth, top 10 in education, top 10 in infrastructure, healthcare, and government efficiencies. I just don't think that the career politicians who got us in this mess will do anything different and can't get us out of it. My opponent has been in state government for 44 years. He just can't deliver the change that we need. And my promise to you, as your next governor, I'll always focus on making the hard decision that's right for the next generation and not the next election. So I look forward to visiting with you tonight and talking about how we can make Oklahoma a great place to live, work, worship, and raise a family.
Mr. Stitt, thank you. Those were the opening statements. Let's get to the questions now. And for the candidates and also for our viewers across Oklahoma, our panelists have grouped their questions into categories. We have those categories for you: education, health, marijuana, economy, criminal justice, and politics, as well as those attack ads. Now, question one comes from KOCO anchor Abigail Ogle, and we will start with education, Abby.
Good evening. Want to go back to April, the statewide teacher walkout making national headlines where teachers vowed to remember in November. Mr. Stitt, you opposed the bill that ended the walkout. Mr. Edmondson, you supported it, but you both acknowledged that Oklahoma needs to do more to fund education, not just the teacher pay raise, but education needs in general. Now is really your chance to convince anyone who's concerned about education to vote for you. What would you say to teachers, students, and parents?
You know, education is going to be the top in my administration. In a Stitt administration, we're going to be focused on being top 10 in education. So I think we have to pay teachers what market is. You know, it's a business principle. You have to pay teachers what they do in the states around us: Texas, Kansas, Arkansas, Colorado. So I want all the teachers to know that my focus is, in my education plan, to get them to number one in the region. It's a small lift. The legislature actually got them to number two in the region in teacher pay. I think that's going to go a long way to show our teachers in that profession that they're respected and they're appreciated. And then I want to focus on really the outcomes. We've got to focus on getting our kids ready for the workforce. And that's why I'm running for governor, folks. We have to look at not only Common Ed, but also career techs and higher ed, get those folks working together, because the jobs of tomorrow are different than the jobs of yesterday. And I want to get our kids ready for that workforce.
Mr. Edmondson, what do you have to say to educators and parents?
Well, when the teachers announced that if the legislature didn't meet their goal of funding education by April 1, that they would walk on the Capitol, I announced that if they walked, I would walk with them, and I did. And I'm proud that I stood with the teachers when they were talking to the legislatures about the needs of state government. The legislature stepped up. They passed a $400 million-plus revenue package and a $6,000 pay raise for teachers, which is a great start. But if they thought this was just about teacher pay, they weren't listening to what the teachers say. In a seven-state region that we are in here in Oklahoma, we rank seventh in per capita expenditures on our students. And after the teacher pay raise, we still rank seventh in per capita expenditures on our students. We have to do better. It's going to take more.
Would you like a rebuttal?
You know, the thing that I like to remind Oklahomans is, you know, we had a teacher walkout in 1968, 1979, and also in 1990. Those were all Democratic-controlled years. I'm proud of the Republican legislature who actually got our teachers the pay raise that they need. But folks, we have to fund education. And look, there's 49 other states that give us great examples of how to do it. This is going to take an outsider, a fresh approach, a business approach to get the dollars that we need into our classrooms. And I'll do that as your next governor.
Let's go now to Brett Bagansky.
Talking about pay and money for the classroom, where specifically is that money going to come from in order to improve education in our state?
Mr. Edmondson.
Well, what I've recommended since last year when I first announced is that we go to three areas, none of which raise taxes on most Oklahoma families. One is to put the gross production tax back at 7%, where it used to be. We lowered it in order to incentivize horizontal drilling. It worked. They no longer need the incentive. Number two is to do away with the capital gains loophole for millionaires. It was also an experiment. It never worked. We have lost $474 million over a five-year period because of that loophole, and 70% of that went to people earning over $1 million a year. That one needs to go also. And the third is the other 50 cents on a pack of cigarettes. Those three things would bring in $300 million additional dollars, the same amount that was recommended by Step Up Oklahoma when they said we needed $700 million and we passed $400 million, which Mr. Stitt said he would have vetoed.
You have 1 minute.
Yeah, this is a big difference between my opponent and me. You know, his solution is always more taxes on hardworking Oklahomans. I don't even know why we're talking about new taxes. We raised $500 million in taxes last year. We have $500 million more in revenue coming in because the economy is booming. Folks, I'm not for any new taxes until we fix the structural problems. My opponent talks about $300 million. I want Oklahomans to know $300 million is 1.5% efficiencies in a $20 billion budget. Folks, I'm about results. I'm not about new taxes. And we have to have an outsider, a fresh set of eyes on these problems, or it's going to be more of the same if we keep electing the same career politicians who got us in this mess. Folks, I'm ready to lead. I have innovative ideas to get us to the next level.
You have a 30-second rebuttal if you'd like it.
Thank you. I would, as a matter of fact, because this is not a big difference between the candidates. This is a huge difference between the candidates. Mr. Stitt believes that he can give teachers more pay raises, do more for education, do more for health, bring down prison population without any new revenues. He is dreaming. The money is not there unless we make sure it's there. I have a plan to do that does not raise taxes on ordinary Oklahomans, just those hardworking millionaires.
We want to stay on the topic of education, and let's head to our panelists with Monty.
The dean of the UCO College of Education and Professional Studies recently released a report stating that the state could save $27 million by consolidating school districts. Have you read the report, and what is your position on consolidation?
Mr. Stitt?
I have not read that report, but you know, consolidation is a local county decision. So I think we have to tweak our funding formula. Folks, we have the same issues that every other state does. So that's what I'm so frustrated about, is why our outcomes are 45th in education. We can do so much better. But when you look at our funding formula, we punish local districts that want to do more. I graduated from Norman High School, and if Norman High School raises $1 locally, they don't get to keep that dollar. They get subtracted from the state equalization formula. So there's no incentive for any district to pay their teachers more, to invest in technology, to have smaller class sizes. Folks, we've got to look at how other states are funding education and stop doing the same things that we did in 1968, 1979, or 1990, or we're going to get the exact same results.
You have 1 minute.
The decision on whether or not to consolidate schools is fundamentally a decision to be made by local school boards. I don't think we have any disagreement on that. We have to trust that local school boards are going to do what they feel is in the best interest of the students in that school district, and that parents will support board members who are acting in the best interest of the students in those districts. That does not mean we cannot have administrative savings in the provision of education across the state of Oklahoma. We can do that. We can make changes. We can encourage and incentivize consolidation of districts without forcing it out of Oklahoma City. I'm prepared to do that. We can take messages to local school boards on how they can save money, how they can save administrative costs, and we need to be about the business of doing that.
Mr. Sitt?
Yeah, I want to address something earlier that my opponent said. You know, his $300 million proposal by taxing the oil and gas industry and the other folks, it's really fuzzy math, because he promises that not only to education, but health care and roads and bridges. So $1 billion worth of promises for $300 million in new tax increases. Folks, we can find it in efficiencies. It's only 1.5% efficiencies. We have to start talking about results instead of new taxes. That's the solution that every politician always brings up. I'm different.
Okay, let's move on to our next question with Scott.
Thanks, Jessica. Gentlemen, Oklahoma has some of the worst health outcomes in the nation. We consistently rank at the top for obesity-related illnesses like heart disease, cancer, stroke, and diabetes, and for related issues like depression and suicide. Would you expand Medicaid through the Affordable Care Act so more Oklahoma families could access health care?
Mr. Edmondson?
Short answer is yes, I would. We've got 153,000 Oklahomans who work full-time, earn too much to qualify for Medicaid, and don't earn enough to be able to opt into the insurance pool and afford private health insurance. They would benefit from an expansion of Medicaid. And these are our tax dollars. We're sending it to Washington. They're being spent in other states to provide for the medical needs of people in Michigan and Minnesota and California and Pennsylvania. I want to bring those tax dollars home and take care of the medical needs of people who would qualify under the Medicaid expansion. And incidentally, while we're doing that, we're going to take a great step forward in keeping hospitals open. And it's not going to keep every hospital open, and it's not the solution in all instances. But hospitals that are on a thin margin, if we start compensating for currently uncompensated care, we're going to keep some of those hospitals open, and I think that's a good thing for rural Oklahoma.
Mr. Stitt?
You know, as I've traveled to all 77 counties meeting with our great Oklahomans, that's a huge concern is our rural hospitals. How are we getting those dollars to our rural hospitals, to our nursing homes? This is a state agency called Medicaid. It's the Healthcare Authority Board that runs Medicaid. It is a $5.5 billion agency. Folks, it's grown from $3 billion to $5.5 billion. Nobody is accountable. So one of the main things we have to do is make sure those dollars are getting into our rural hospitals and into our nursing homes. So Medicaid expansion is just a Band-Aid on these problems. I believe in a trampoline, in a system that helps people get off a system and not a hammock. We can't create a system that keeps people on a system and dependency. We need to get them back into the workforce, back into working and into jobs.
Would you like a response?
Well, yes. I'm very curious on what that trampoline's going to look like because we haven't heard yet. And if we're going to be funding trampolines, that's a bit of an extravagant expense for state government, and I think that's one of the places we can cut waste. I believe people need help, hospitals need help, and expanding Medicaid is a good step forward in accomplishing that.
Okay, let's stay on the topic of health care with Abby now.
On the similar token here, the only hospital in Pauls Valley recently shut its doors. And as we've mentioned, many of Oklahoma's rural hospitals, unfortunately, are in danger of suffering the same fate. What specifically will you do to ensure that all Oklahomans will have access to quality health care within a reasonable driving distance from their homes?
Mr. Stitt?
Yeah, you know, we have got to. This is a national problem. There's healthcare systems, rural hospitals all over the nation that are struggling. And when you think about delivering services and how do you get those dollars into our hospitals, you know, right now our reimbursement rates are less than the states around us. For example, you know, I'm in the mortgage business, and so we've got, if interest rates today are, let's say, 5%, we've got to create a 5% interest rate. If we have, if we would never create all the management, the infrastructure, and then whatever's left over, we deliver 6% interest rates. That's what our government does. They build infrastructure, management teams, all the expense, and whatever's left over are reimbursements for our hospitals and our nursing homes. It is a bottom-up approach, folks. That is a business approach. We have to start with how we're delivering those dollars to our hospitals in our nursing homes, then we build the management after that. This is a management problem. It's a structural problem that I'll fix as governor.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Edmondson?
Well, we're doing some good work with federally qualified health care centers that are picking up part of the load, particularly in low-income areas of the state, and they're doing a pretty good job on it. In the short term, I do think it's imperative that we opt into the Medicaid expansion to try to keep hospitals, particularly in rural areas, open as long as we can. Eventually, I think we're going to move to an area where in remote areas of the state of Oklahoma, we convert full-service hospitals to kind of triage emergency facilities where they stabilize a condition for transport to a hospital with more services at a further distance away. It's probably going to be impossible in the long run to have full-service hospitals in every small town in Oklahoma. But there are creative solutions that I'm prepared to work on to make sure our citizens have the health care needs met.
You have 30 seconds if you'd like.
Sure. You know, I talked to the CEO of the Pauls Valley Hospital, and he said very plainly, the Medicaid expansion would not have saved our hospital. This was a management problem, folks. You know, the real solutions, it's a Band-Aid to take more federal dollars that have the mandates and the handcuffs on it. We need to look at more doctors to our rural communities. We need to look at maybe doctor-owned hospitals, letting them buy in. We've got to look at other revenue sources for our rural hospitals and really strategically place them throughout the state, make sure that we have the access for every single Oklahoman.
We have several topics we want to cover this evening. So our next one, marijuana in Oklahoma, and we'll begin with Brett Bagansky.
Both of you are on record supporting medical marijuana in Oklahoma. However, Mr. Stitt, you did not support State Question 788. Mr. Edmondson, you did. So how pleased with you with the new medical marijuana law, with the progress, I mean, and what more needs to be done with it?
Mr. Edmondson?
Well, the health department took a good start, but they were called up short by passing rules and regulations that a lot of people felt were frustrating. The state question that passed with 57% of the vote, and the rules were subsequently withdrawn. The health department has now worked on new rules which would implement medical marijuana. At the same time, they refused to call it a joint committee. They call it a bicameral committee of the House and Senate are working on potential legislation to also meet those needs. I'm looking forward to the results of the legislation and the final results of the health department rules as governor to make sure that the state question that passed is implemented properly and in a way that safeguards the health and safety of all Oklahomans.
Mr. Stitt, how pleased are you with the progress of the new medical marijuana law, and what do you believe needs to be done?
You know, as I've traveled the state, you know, people are okay with medical marijuana. If it's actually going to help a patient, I think everybody's fine with that. I've went and visited with pain management clinics to ask them if they would prescribe medical marijuana, and they said, yeah, in certain situations, it helps people get off opioids. So that's already passed. We're not arguing that fact. It's going to help some people, but now we have to implement it. And so we have the legislature right now is working on that. We've got to think how we keep the public safe because we have businesses and we've got trucking companies that are moving products. And how do we keep our industries? How do they test for this for medical marijuana? How do they have a safe work environment? So there's a lot of consequences. There's a lot of unintended consequences that are going on right now that we have to make sure that our businesses know how to do it, that we keep the public safe as people are using this substance.
Your 30-second rebuttal?
Well, we certainly hope that the health department in their new regulations have met those needs and that the legislature is prepared to step up. In the meantime, we have issues like safety in the workplace. We have issues like how is this going to be regulated in school properties. Those issues have yet to be addressed. I'm looking forward to the early efforts to do that. And if they haven't solved that problem by January, I'll be working on it as governor.
Our next question comes from Abigail Local.
On the same topic of marijuana, let's take it a step further. Supporters of this say it would bring in much needed tax revenue to the state. Do you support legalizing recreational marijuana use? Why or why not?
You have 1 minute.
Yeah, the short answer is no. There's too many unintended consequences by legalizing marijuana recreationally. It's still illegal federally, and I would not put our state through that. You can look at the consequences that are happening to Colorado. The homelessness has increased. You've got insurance costs have risen. Business insurance has risen. You know, that's not something we want to put our state through. So medical is fine. That's what passed. But recreational, until it's legal federally, I wouldn't want to put our state through that.
Mr. Edmondson?
Well, I would urge caution on recreational marijuana. We have an opportunity in Oklahoma to watch Colorado, Oregon, Washington, California, and other jurisdictions that have legalized recreational marijuana to just see if the downside outweighs the upside. We know what the upside is. Colorado's getting about $400 million in new revenue as a result of that. But there are problems. It's a cash economy. Because it is still illegal at the federal level, banks can't do it, credit cards can't be used, so it's a cash economy. If the day comes when an initiative petition goes on the ballot or the legislature moves to enact it, we will then have the ability to avoid the mistakes that have been made in other states and make sure we capitalize on the strong suit in states where they've done things properly. And I would urge wait and see and take advantage of that opportunity to study.
Mr. Stitt, you have 30 seconds.
You know, when you think about marijuana use, those are some treatment things that we need to do a better job in our state. The opioid use, the crisis that we have in some of our drug uses, we've got to invest in educational outcomes. We've got to invest and get our private sector and get our churches and getting different nonprofits on this issue. And I'll do that and lead that as governor to help with the overall drug use and problems in our state.
Gentlemen, thank you both for staying on time in our first half hour. We have much more to get to. The gubernatorial debate between Drew Edmondson and Kevin Stitt continues in our next half hour. One of them will lead our state for the next 4 years. Coming up, we're going to talk about our state's economy and those attack ads. We'll be back.